to continue with our day today. And next up is Patrick Park. He's an electrical engineer, and he's in Dr. Ali Khan's lab, and he's going to be talking to you about the BIDS data standard.
Alright, thanks, Jason. So the goal of this talk, I wanted to keep it really, really informal, and if you walk away from anything, I'd rather you walk away with a general high-level understanding of BIDS and its purpose and what it's supposed to do rather than the minute technical details. We'll be following up with more tutorials and stuff catered towards the details and technical stuff later. So with that being said, let's say you started with a room like this. Like your friend or someone asked you to house it, and you walk in and it looks like this. He says, I don't really care, you can just take whatever you want, man, but you have no idea what's going on. So how would we go about organizing this? Well, probably you would start with some shelving, right? You'd probably want some labels to figure out what's going on. And really, your friend is completely unavailable. He's on a mountain or somewhere, and he's unreachable. So you'd probably appreciate something like water the plants, some notes that he left to himself, like reminders, check mail on Mondays. Just remind him to graduate that you're at school to do this. So instead of a room, your friend or your lab mate now gives you a USB, and you open it up and he says, man, I have all this great data that I want to share with you, but it looks like this. And you just have no idea how to make sense of any of this, and it's just like random numbers that at some point meant something, but now they're just gibberish. And even though this data is really valuable, it's basically useless now. So the problems in data sharing that we see are basically difference in file organizing and naming preferences. And this is really just personal preference or whatever. And this is even I'm not even consistent with my own file preferences. It's just what the flavor of the day is, basically. And an unclear data set description. So let's say you acquired a bunch of scans, but you didn't really clearly document what happened during those scans or what parameters you used. So that's a really important part of it. And secondly, it's difficult to validate the completeness of a data set. And this can come in different flavors, but most importantly, let's say you open your a data set that's been given to you and it says subject 1 to subject 40. And you scroll over the folder and you see 39 items selected. So what happened to the one person, right? Like now you just gotta count 1, 2, 3, 4, 7, what's going on? Here's where brain imaging data structure comes in. This is basically, at first it sounds a little intimidating, but all it is an organizational structure that I wanted to talk to you about. It's basically trying to get that messy room into a more organized format so you don't have to deal with it. And yeah, so at the moment it's used for neuroimaging and behavioral data, but there's other things being added on as well. So who is it for? Well, first, if there are any PIs or people who just have data, it's to transfer data between students. So let's say you have a master's student who works on a project for 2 years and then they graduate and then they leave. Well, now you want to continue that study and transfer that data, but without a standard formatting scheme, the master's student may be across the world now and it's hard to communicate. Well, what did this mean? What did this mean? Underscore, whatever. And then for workflow or tool developers, this doesn't have to mean you're a professional developer. If you've ever developed any sort of workflow or tool, you know that one of the challenges is trying to figure out what the input is going to look like. So what format are the files going to be in, and how are you going to go through subject by subject and file by file to process your data? And so it being standardized, it would really help develop tools that can match that standardized input. And finally, for researchers, basically your data will be more organized and more likely to be shared, basically. It is called the brain imaging data structure, but there's zero programming required. And as a new user, you can use bids with absolutely zero programming knowledge. That doesn't mean that programming doesn't help. If you're familiar with programming, or if you're an expert, you can use some of the more automated tools out there. You can create scripts to make things quicker. You can always develop new things, but bids in general is all it is a organizational scheme or a like a format. So really, there's no programming required. And that being said, there's no programming required, there's no excuses but to use it. So how does it work? It's going back to the items that we talked about earlier. Roughly, we're gonna talk about file naming, folder structure, and a data set description, just on a high level, just organizational tools that we talked about earlier. And what we see here is a bids data set. So basically, you've got a bunch of folders that are being that have been converted out into nifties. But what we want to do is keep this thing, keep up the file structure in an organized format. So without getting too much into details, this would be your entire folder. So this is kind of like your project folder. And then you have a file to list your participants and the details about them. Then each subject gets their own folder. And the different types of scans are categorized. So not every scan or every study is going to have all of these types. But for example, if you have an anatomical T1 weighted scan, some functional, old scans, and some diffusion imaging, then those go into subcategories under each subject. So really, it's not anything. I mean, you guys are probably using some form of organization in your data, but this is really just a way to make sure that we can all sit down and say, okay, everybody get on the same page about, for example, how it's not anatomy and the or anatomical and then sub 1, 2, 3, it's the other way around. It's just the way that someone like we can sit down and clarify what the rules should be. And what types of data is it for? So it's really for all types of neuroimaging research, including structural susceptibility, arterial spin labeling, EEG, PET, fMRI, and many more. And even if there isn't one currently available for your data set, which there probably is, then there are is an active effort for experts in that field to continue developing bids to match the all the different types of data that are available and being researched out there. So once again, this is the folder structure that we talked about earlier, but just with a little bit more detail. Effectively, this is the rough subject and subfolders. As well here, you see these files called JSON, data set descriptions. And this is kind of that list or note to self that your friend might have left for you in the room, saying, okay, this is a description of the data and how it was acquired and like what was done during the process of acquiring it. And what might this look like? Well, if you have a some kind of scan with stimulus or events, then it's just a standard table, basically, of onset, duration, trial, response time. Something called metadata, so effectively that's data about the data and how it was acquired. These are basically like scanning parameters. And finally, subject information. So this is to help combat the problem that I was talking about earlier. You're given a data set. You also want to be given a corresponding, basically an Excel sheet, saying what's going on there. And now this tool is very interesting. This is a bids validator. And given any bids data set, you'll be able to upload this, your data set, to the web, basically, to get it checked and see if it actually does indeed comply with the bids format. And so what this means is that you'll be able to plug it into other people's pipelines that are designed to take bids apps, or you'll be able to basically make it fit with anything that was designed for bids.
Quick question. Do you actually upload your data to use that,
oh.
Or does it just run totally on your system?
I'm pretty sure it just runs on your system. It's not getting up, like, it's not, yeah, that's true. It's not getting, like, shared, but it's
being, through your browser.
It's done locally, but yeah. Yeah, so if you have confidential data, it's still, like, and so you'll receive, like, feedback, basically, and we'll go more into this detail later during our tutorial, where you see that, given certain subjects, it'll be able to detect this information from the data set description that I was alluding to earlier. Then it'll be able to find what tasks, so this is all automatic, find what tasks you were trying to, you were giving to the subjects, and what available types of scans you have. Earlier we saw it under the funk folder, some old scans, and under the anatomical folder, some T1 weighted scans. And it'll give you feedback, we'll go through this more later, how you can fix it to become more compliant. And once you've gotten it to this point, this is basically where your gravy is. Because once you have your data in BidsApps, you get access to free pipelines that basically automatically process your bids data set. And this can be a number of different things. So for example, pre-processing your data, performing corrections that we know should be performed on many different types of data, such as non-linearity correction, or just quality check on your controls, or quality check on your scans. And these are generated without you having to code anything. If you get your data into BIDS format, you can use more pipelines that other people have built because your data is able to fit into their pipelines. So if nothing else, this is should be one of the key motivations. And current research, so this is one of those things, of course, it's data sharing. It comes down to how many people are using it, and the more people that use it, the more effective it's going to be. This was released, not even that long ago, probably a couple of years ago at most, but we're currently up to over 5,000 researchers and over 25 BidsApps have been released. So depending on what's relevant to your study, that's 25 free pipelines that you basically get if you if you convert your data into BIDS format. And just to give you guys an idea of the scale, this is roughly the amount of people that can fit into Jurassic Park on game day. I believe game two is at 6 p.m. tonight. And the development is through an open source community, which means anyone can contribute. Just in about 2 minutes, I'll open up the Google Docs, and that's literally what it is. Remember earlier I said there's no programming required. Like, people that are developers or contributors, generally that means go to some GitHub and then you go to like push and whatever. Like, this is just, there's a Google Doc that 5,000 people are working on, and you just make a comment. And of course there's some moderators and stuff, but that's effectively how this thing was developed. You can say, wait a minute, I think this file should be named this way. And just to give credit where credit is due, the original development was through the INCF and the Cold Direct Lab at Stanford. So there'll be a more detailed follow-along tutorial of how we go from just a raw BIDS data set, or raw non-BIDS data set at 1 p.m. Then, so I'll take questions in a bit. But before that, I just want to show you guys the Google Doc. So this is basically what it looks like. And you can see that there's just all of these people here kind of reading it. And this person, like, we don't know who they are, but all they had to do was say some stuff that they know about FSL. And really, this is a fairly like long document, but all of these people are just effectively commenting and saying and discussing, saying, wait a minute, I think this type of file should be named this way. And one last thing I want to point out here is that earlier I mentioned that it's really designed to be usable by all types of neuroimaging researchers. So if it doesn't exist, then someone's going to create kind of a subchapter for it. And then experts from that field are going to go and discuss in the IEEG page or the functional preprocessing derivatives page. And these are typically led by experts in that field, but also they're just open discussion for anybody who works with this type of data. So with that, I'll just take some questions, but otherwise, we'll see you guys at the tutorial.
So how easy is it to actually access the data from that raw stuff? Not to put a pipeline and say, I want to write something and treat that data.
So what do you mean? There's also some ongoing work. I don't know if we're touching on it in any of the talks today, but if you go to Datalad, or datalad.org, I forget what it is. But this is basically, what someone has created is a way of having Git repositories for data sets. They've created this, so if you go get to the data portal, to build data sets. So this is essentially a curated selection of, it could actually be a web crawled collection of big data sets out there that are all indexed through this Git repository. So even accessing, like downloading the data sets can be done through an API now too. This even has tools for searching for metadata. So you can actually go and say, I need all subjects with, age 20 female, and just download everything, right? So from basically all the data that's openly available.
Yeah. How difficult was it to adapt this to EEG?
I personally have not. I don't work with EEG data, but I think if
we
just
go
to the...
Here, people have been working on extensions. So there's the EEG extension, there's an intracranial EEG extension, there's an MEG, magnetoencephalography extension. So, and these are curated, moderated by different people around the world. So they've essentially adopted that core functionality for regular imaging to other modalities.
So if these,
as far as I know, they haven't been able to settle on a single file format for EEG because there's so many out there. But what they've, they've just standardized everything around a number of file formats. So they've specified a number of sort of possible raw data formats and how to describe it. But it's currently still very much under development. But
so if we were to create a base format for another modality, how would you do this? more of a collaborative effort.
Exactly. Yeah. I think that's why it's had such good adoption, just because everyone is involved in this generation, rather than one group saying, this is how it should be done.
And like, it was easier for neuroimaging data, because there were only a few different file types that people, the packages used, like FSL bases and stuff on NIFTYs that are zipped, and SPM bases and stuff on individual volume NIFTYs, I believe, SPM does, or DICOMs. So everything, it, just being like, okay, we're all going to decide to use a vendor-free data system is different for neuroimaging. But like for MRS, everything's vendor-specific. So if they do, if anyone ever builds an MRS extension, which is magnetic resonance spectroscopy, they're going to have to just do the same thing as EEG, just have the label and then dot RDA for Siemens, dot whatever Philips, because that's, you can't, you're not going to create a converter to a generalized format.
Want to create a scanner or something or other, and you need to know what fields are valid, what's are not. You basically, I think XSLT is the XML equivalent. It's like it's the definition of what's good and not. So it's a PDF.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I mean, the bits validator has, I guess, has that information encoded somewhere. I don't know if it's in like a specific.
So that they've just taken this and curated it into. Either way,
just a giant file that you can.
Well, like, see, this is great, but this is not easily parsable by a computer.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So if you had the entire BIDS world in a single .json or whatever the format is, then programs can use that as anything in here is good, anything not in here is not good, and it makes it easy to create tools.
That's a good.
I mean, yeah. So it's indirectly sort of there in the BIDS validator. I don't know.